anything. Would you let me go?
Why are you helping me?
Why? Do you think I care for you so that you'll betray me and make a difference?
Does sarcasm help?
I'm going to be a king of us.
From the beginning of time, that's a very long story.
Ladies and gentlemen, FanExpo Dallas is proud to present to you for his very first North American appearance here in Dallas, Peter Capaldi!
Thank you.
No, they were saying they love me.
No, it's you know.
How you doing, boss?
I'm good. It's great to be here. I'd like to see more of Texas, but all I've seen is the convention center and the hotel.
Yeah. Well, everything is big in Texas, so it'll take you a while. You gotta spend a couple months here to check everything out. It is such a pleasure to have you here with our organization, of course, but of course, here in Texas. And we're flabbergasted. I'm flabbergasted. I'm just a fan of everything you do.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Yeah. We're going to talk a little bit real quick, and then we're going to go ahead and open the floor up to questions. But I have to ask you, when we were watching the clips that we had going on up there, it seemed there were very, and you as who, we see varying hairstyles that was going on, even up until this point. Whose decision was it for you to have the first hairstyle, and did you have any say whatsoever on how you should look on screen?
The thing is, when you start Doctor Who, there's a lot of kind of worry about how you look, and there are like whole committees of people sort of staring at you and saying, oh, his hair's right, his hair's wrong, or we like that jacket, we don't like this jacket. And in fact, I sort of was sort of fielding all of this stuff, trying to bring myself to the part. And actually, I always wanted to have longer hair. I always really wanted to have hair more like this. But it was decided, it's great how your hair can get a little flurry of applause like that, isn't it?
It's part
that's
of
the hair fans.
Hair fans.
It was just decided I should have short hair, so I did. But it looks pretty good.
It looks excellent. Very, very impressive. We're gonna go back and forth anyway. So we have all of our questions, as you know already, down the center here. Hi.
Oh, hi.
How old are you?
10.
10. All righty. Yeah.
What's your name?
Emily.
Hi, Emily.
Hi. Thank you for coming to Dallas. My question for today is, what's your most embarrassing or awkward moment on the set?
Good question. Oh, I'm sure you don't have to think that hard.
Well, it's very embarrassing when you get your lines wrong, or when you are, I try stuff. When we work, you try ideas to see if they work, and they don't always work. Sometimes they're very silly. And don't come out very effectively. So I have embarrassing moments every single day. But if you're an actor, and if you're interested in acting, you must get used to having embarrassing moments, because that's how you find good stuff. You must be prepared to be vulnerable.
So there are a lot of situations that don't work that's actually has been filmed.
Yeah, but they're usually, you're on the way to finding something that does work.
But I mean, they could show up in a blooper reel.
You know what? I'd love to see a blooper reel, but the show is so intense in terms of the amount of filming that has to be done in a small amount of time. I don't think anyone's got time to cut one together. You know?
They'll make time. Yeah. Okay, hi. Thank you, sweetheart. Appreciate it. Next question.
Hi.
Hello.
So, in The Witch's Familiar, how did it feel to ride around instead of one of your worst enemies?
You mean in Davros' chair?
Yes.
It was absolutely great. but you know, I don't want to give away too many secrets, but the way that Davros' chair moves around is like, you know, do you ever go to the post office and there's like an old lady there in the line on an electric sort of wheelchair thing, like this with her shopping and stuff? That's what's inside Davros's. And you know, I'm really respectful of the old ladies because it's really hard to drive. And when I did it at first, you know, I had to come through quite a narrow little doorway, which a Dalek can get through. I couldn't get through.
You got banged into the sides.
And then I discovered that the crew had put a learner plate on it. Because I couldn't drive. It's terrible.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi there. Good morning.
Mr. Capaldi, thank you for coming to Texas. I run a small fan group in San Antonio, and I'm here with about a dozen of my closest friends, and I need to thank you personally. My world would be so much horror and so much more lonely if it weren't for you and your work. I found so many friends as a result of it.
Oh, great.
Awesome.
What I wanted to ask is, I know Doctor Who is your dream job, but every actor goes out for roles that, for one reason or another, they don't get. What was the one that you really, really wish you had? Maybe you were their second choice for and just didn't get it.
Oh, you know, that changes from, it depends upon what your financial situation is. Because sometimes you might be like, I'd really like to play Hamlet, and they don't give you Hamlet, or sometimes you're like, we don't have any money to buy food or pay the rent, so you really want to do anything then. So there's been lots of parts that were like, you know, the detective's friend, or the third banana, which I would have loved to have got because I needed the money at the time, but I didn't.
Well, this permanent job, like she was saying, that you have right now is putting you into a level of icon status now, just being part of the franchise of Doctor Who. So I think you'll be eating well for a good while now.
We'll see.
Hi.
Hello. Welcome to FanExpo.
Thank you.
If you could write your own Doctor Who episode, what would it be about?
I think that I would like to see, I'd like to see how the Doctor and his granddaughter. Woo. Came to be. What is that situation? Is that really his granddaughter? If that's his granddaughter, is she a Time Lord? Or is she adopted? Or is it just a weird kind of, is he looking after her? There's some intense kind of psychic or genetic link between them. So I would love to know what that was. And also, of course, he left her and promised he would come back, and he never came back. So I would like to see him come back and meet you again. But with Daleks and monsters and explosions.
Very long. But that's still as material to explore.
Yeah.
Obviously, make suggestions to your writers and stuff like that. Hi.
Hello.
Hi. So we've had two members from the thick of it guest on the show. So I was wondering, who else would you like from that show to guest on Doctor Who? Villain or perhaps good guy?
You mean of any actors?
Yeah, that have been on the thick of it, yes.
That have been on the thick of it?
Yes. We've had two.
Yeah. Well, anyone, the cast of The Thick of It were extraordinary.
Yeah.
They were absolutely brilliant actors. So any one of them would do a wonderful job. So any of them, really.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We'll get more out of him later, okay? Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Oh, is the Doctor the hybrid?
Get out.
I love you. I love you.
No, stand by. Hold. Hold for the answer.
You know I can't answer that question.
Now get out. Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
I know this is a really silly one, but if I challenged you to a lightsaber duel, would you accept?
Easily, yeah.
And he will kick your ass. Yeah. He's still challenging.
Yeah, that's right, but that's because he's fictional.
Yeah.
He can say anything he likes.
Hi.
Hi, Peter.
Hello.
So, first of all, we're all really happy that you're here. Great job on Doctor Who. Great job as a doctor. I wouldn't worry too much about that third banana roll. It's fine. So my question, I was totally, completely freaking out yesterday when I met you, and I know you're a huge Doctor Who fan as well. Have you ever met anyone from the show that you just completely were starstruck over?
From the show.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I was very young, it wasn't technically, well, depends where you stand, it wasn't technically Doctor Who, but I met Peter Cushing. Star Wars, who was in Star Wars, but was well known to me growing up because he was in a lot of horror movies. I'm sure that's why he was in Star Wars, because I think George Lucas and Steven Spielberg loved the work of Hammer Pictures, and Peter Cushing was one of the stars of, and of course he played the Doctor in the big movie versions of Doctor Who. But I remember, and it's pertinent to this kind of experience here of coming to a big sort of fan convention. He was like opening a charity event in my hometown, and there was a very small queue of people, a small line, about half a dozen of us, because they didn't do things like this. And he signed an autograph for me, and he gave me, you know, they didn't sell autographs or anything in those days, they just gave me this 10x8 photograph of himself, and he signed it, and signed his name. And I loved this autograph so much, I based my own autograph on his. Because he has the same initials. He's Peter Cushing,
yeah.
And I'm PC also.
Nice.
And he was absolutely charming, so that was lovely.
Thank you.
A little bit on your childhood. You, from what I understand, if you can verify this or not, received a script.
Yeah.
Something. At what age was that? A Doctor Who script, in fact, right?
Yeah. I think I was about 15.
16?
Yeah.
How did that come about?
What it was I was really crazy about the show, and I would write to Doctor Who, or to whoever would be playing the part, or I would write to the BBC, because we all knew the BBC's address, and you could write to them, and they would send you back a photograph of Doctor Who or whatever. But I wrote, like, there was a period I went through when I was writing, like, every week. Because the show would be off the air, and I'd be saying, when is it coming back, and what's going to happen, well done, and all blah. And clearly I was clearly very interested in the making of the show. And the producer of the show, well, one day I came home, and there was a package waiting for me. And I opened this package up, and there were two scripts. For the forthcoming season that hadn't been broadcast, set designs and floor plans, these were BBC technical scripts that would be used on the floor with a cameraman, and I didn't even know a thing called a script existed. I didn't know how they made TV shows. And so suddenly I saw how they made a show, and I was absolutely entranced by it. And in a way that I thought this was confirmation that I wanted to do this. I don't mean just be Doctor Who, I mean, but to be an actor and be in that world. And it was sent to me by a man called Barry Letts, who was the producer of Doctor Who. He was a brilliant producer. And I think they just did that in those days. They said if there was someone who got in touch and they thought that person was interested, they felt it was their duty to try and encourage them.
That is freaky. Yeah.
But the most amazing thing was that many, many years later, I had a friend, I have a friend called Crispin, who was an actor who I worked with. And we enjoyed each other's company. And I'd known him for about a year before he said to me, you know, my father is Barry Letts. And I finally got to meet Barry.
This is freaky.
In person, and thank him in person.
And you were 15. Do you still have that script? Now, all that information.
Yeah, I do.
eBay. Wow.
But it's a testament to Barry and to the BBC, which is the most incredible organization. It's a publicly owned, in our terms, in British terms, that means we, the taxpayer, own it. It's our BBC. And so there is a responsibility within the BBC to reach out to
the people.
That's
right, to the people.
For it.
And they gave back to the people.
And they do it.
You're a recipient of that.
And the circle goes on.
Wow, the circle is complete. Circle is complete. Wow. Awesome. Hi.
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 Hi, Peter. Thank you so much for coming. I'm excited that you're here.
Pleasure.
I wanted to ask if you actually had control of the TARDIS and you could pick up three famous historical figures or people from history, who would you invite aboard the TARDIS?
Oh, gosh. That sounds tough. Well, you know, I think, well, this year we go get Prince. We'd go get Alan Rickman. And we'd go get David.
Wow.
And we would party.
Thank you.
Wow. I'll be in the slipstream, you know, kind of thumbing as you guys roll by. It's like, hey, you know, wait for me. It's cool. Hi. Like the dress.
Right.
Thank you. Hello again, Peter.
Hi.
So we know that you love working with Jenna.
Yeah.
So my question is, if you can work with Jenna again as leading actress in anything like TV or movies or whatever, what would it be, and what kind of story would it be?
Well, Jenna's an amazing actress, so she could do anything. You know, so we could be anywhere. We could go and do period stuff or modern stuff. I mentioned it to her as a laugh one day that it would be nice to do. There's a great Willie Russell play called Educating Rita, which I thought would be fun to have a look at, because that's about a young woman from kind of a blue-collar district who goes, again, in Britain we have a thing called the Open University, which is an educational system where it's like a postal educational degree you can get, but you have to go to lectures, and it's about this woman who does that, and she meets this lecturer who has a great influence on her life, but the lecturer is a bit wasted. And that would be me.
Thank you.
But we never did.
Thank you.
I can see you guys on Downton Abbey.
Well,
if it was still on, but I can see you guys showing up at Downton Abbey.
Well, they can't.
Yeah. The Duke of Whovian is here, you know, something like that. Hi.
Hi, Doctor. Do you remember me?
Of course I do. I can't see you because I haven't got my glasses on. It's the voice. I can remember the voice.
Okay, so I've been a fan of you since you played the foul-mouthed Malcolm Tucker. But Doctor Who was what really brought you like a rock star status and all the perks that come with it. So my question is, what's one of the craziest things a fan has given you or said to you? For example, has anyone ever asked you to marry them? And if not, can I be the first?
Security.
I'm just thinking of a legally binding answer. Yeah. Somebody has asked me to marry them before. In fact, I am actually married. But I appreciate your interest. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
In other circumstances.
But considering this is your first American appearance, everything you've done so far has been either in Canada or Europe or thus far. So they really, other than today or maybe yesterday, can anything you can relate to the fans or experience with the fans at this convention yesterday and prior to your appearance here on stage? Anything struck you?
I think the, you know, it's the enthusiasm and the affection in which the show is held. I think if you like this show, it runs very deep. You know, there's something, people always ask me what is it that's special about Doctor Who? I don't really know what it is, but I know that it captures people's hearts in a very powerful way. And every fan that I've met here has been full of that. They have expressed that. And you've got to remember that we spend 9 months of the year, you know, basically in a television factory, you know, locked inside, making Doctor Who, which is a great job, but we never come out. We don't get to meet all you guys. And we don't get to see the effect that the show has on people. And particularly, we don't get to see the effect that it has internationally. And for us to be aware of how warmly you feel about our show is a great, great thing, because it also teaches us to try and make it for you. You know, the more we know of you, then the more we can try and do the best version of Doctor Who for you.
That's very important. I like that. That's very nice to say. Awesome. Hi.
Hi, I'm Cassie, and I know this is really weird, but I was just wondering what your favorite musical was.
My favorite musical.
This is interesting.
Oh God. Well, I'm not really a huge musical theatre fan. I've got nothing against it. I was once in the show called Blood Brothers, which was a musical, which I liked. I love cabaret. Cabaret is an amazing show. The story that it tells, and the music, and the atmosphere. So what's your favorite?
Oh God, too many. Hamilton, Les Mis, yes, I know. 16 Ponies, I mean.
Yeah. Book of Mormon. Great. The Lion King, I love The Lion King. See, I'm starting now. That was amazing, yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for mentioning Les Mis, because that's one of my favorites right there. Hi.
I was just wondering, if you could change your TARDIS interior to another Doctor's, who would it be and why?
Well, it's no secret that I'm a great fan of the classical TARDIS. Which is what the TARDIS really is underneath all of that stuff. So I think I would go for a cross between William Hartnell's TARDIS and Tom Baker's TARDIS.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hi.
Hi.
Nice to see you.
You too. I'm Hi. Peter Capaldi, I was wondering...
What's your name?
Serenity.
Full name?
Serenity Joe Clark.
Serenity Joe Clark, okay. You're through to Peter Capaldi.
He's sending you mail. How old are you?
9. I was wondering, what was it like when Michelle Gomez, you, and Gina Coleman were all stuck in a room together for a scriptural reading for the first time?
for a scripture reading.
Maybe we know what she meant, but let's go with that.
Let us pray.
Religion, sorry.
It was great. It was very exciting. We always have, it's a big part of the process of Doctor Who, we always have a big read-through where everyone sits around and reads the script and we all get to hear it for the first time. And it's one of those occasions when everybody who works on the production comes to it. So sometimes there's 200 people there. My very first, you know, appearance as Doctor Who was at a script reading in front of 200 people, so it was terrifying. And so when Jenna and Michelle and me get together and do the thing, there's always a whole pile of other people there. And Stephen, who writes the scripts and runs the show, reads all of the stage directions that are in the script out, and he does it in a very funny and exciting and dramatic way. So the whole experience of the read-through is hugely exciting. And usually when a new character appears, like as soon as Michelle uttered her first words as Missy, or when she said, "You know who I am," that could be on, keep on calling myself Missy, "I am the master," a huge round of applause goes up, you know, from everybody around the table. So it makes it very exciting. So it was great. It's great fun doing that.
Thank you.
And then we do the scripture reading.
My microphone keeps dropping lower and lower and lower for each of
you. Hi.
How old are you?
6.
Wow, good to see you.
You may speak now. You have a question?
I'm so nervous.
You can do it for him too, Mom, if he can't get it out, okay?
When I grow up, I want to be a part of Doctor Who. What should I do to get there?
Awesome, buddy. Awesome.
Great question. Well, you're doing the right thing by coming here. You got to be nice to your mom. You got to be kind to people. You got to work hard and make the very best of the gifts that you have, of your talents, and take them out into the world. And if you work hard and you're kind and you are lucky, that will all be recognized. And if you write to the BBC and say, "I love Doctor Who, I'd love to work on it," they'll maybe put that letter in a file somewhere, and when you're old enough, they may want to see you and talk to you about it. But the important thing is to have that ambition, to want to do that. Because if you want to do something like that, it means that you're a clever and a bright and a creative person. And that's the most important thing to take forward. To take forward that belief in yourself and in the belief of how valuable it is to bring creativity into the world. So you'll do fine.
Now that was scripture. Good job. Hi.
Hello. My name is Lucas, and I was just wondering, you did a Dalek voice last night. What other enemies can you do?
I don't know. I don't remember what other enemies can I do? Cybermen, well, their voices, and they don't tend to speak very much anymore, do they? But then there's the Dong Lang Lang. They used to do a little sort of Stephen Hawkins kind of thing. I haven't practiced that at all. Funny enough, one of my great, I love Julian Bleach, who plays Davros, who, you know, does the voice without any electronic aids whatsoever. When you talk to him, he talks to you like this. Very evil doctor. And do you have a thing called corned beef here? Do you know what corned beef is? Yeah. Is there a cheer, a round of applause for corned beef? So I love Julian, but if Julian was here, I wouldn't know what he looked like. Because he always stayed in the Davros makeup. And I loved talking to him because he was so interesting. He was a brilliant actor and a brilliant actor of who did very, very stylish work, a great show called Chockhead. Peter, a brilliant actor. But I loved just hearing his stories. But I said to him, I would chat to him and say, what have you had for lunch? You know, after lunch, and he'd say, corned beef. Davros in the chair, corned beef. I said, where did you get the corned beef from? I didn't see that on the menu. And he leaned down like this, and he brought out a tin of it, corned beef. And he said he always traveled with half a dozen tins of corned beef, because he was used to staying in theatrical digs where the food might not be very good. So that was his emergency food. It was corned beef.
Thank you.
Wow, here we go. How old are you?
Hi.
Hi, I'm Dakota. Besides a screwdriver and sunglasses, what object would you have to be Sonic?
My ears. sorry, that's not a silly joke. I think, well, the thing about a Sonic is it's just, it can do anything, can't it? That's the trick of it. I think a Sonic microphone would be good. Because then I could see you in close-up. That would be handy. And I think a Sonic lawnmower. Do you have lawnmowers here?
Yes.
Because I hate mowing the lawn. It's the thing I hate most in the world, and so I would just set the Sonic lawnmower off to do that. But as I say, I don't think the toy manufacturers would like that very much.
Okay, so remember, cut your grass. Hey, man.
Hi.
Hello.
My name is Luke. Nice to meet you, Mr. Capaldi.
Nice to meet you. Call me Peter.
All right, nice.
Well, the doctor.
Yeah. Hello, doctor. I was wondering, since you've been here in the U.S., what is your favorite memory while you've been here?
Dallas. Dallas. No, Dallas is... You know, Dallas, you know, it's one of the very weird things because, I arrived yesterday, and I got straight off the plane and I held up at immigration because they didn't, you know, looked at it, said I came from Gallifrey and they didn't buy that. Although the guy at immigration said, where are you going? And I said to the comment, he said, Spider-Man through here the other day. And he looked at me and he said, who are you?
Don't you know who I am?
I said, I'm Doctor Who. And he said, he looked at me and went, you are Doctor Who.
In you go.
So that was funny. No, but actually what was that? So what I'm saying was, I really saw very little of Dallas except for immigration here and the hotel. What is extraordinary, of course, is the people. It's so lovely to hear people. They're so courteous and smart and clever, and your accents are just...
Their accent.
Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful.
They'll tell you they don't have an accent.
No, well, to me, yeah, you do, and it's absolutely beautiful. And also you have a wonderful courtesy, which is extraordinary. The person, you know, talking to you may want to wring your neck or whatever, but they will say it in the most genteel way.
Welcome to the South. Yeah. All right, we got a couple more questions we can get through before he heads on down for autograph and photo ops. So we're just going to make sure that you guys remember to do that. Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
How much did you fangirl your first day on set?
Fanboy. Really not very much because the thing is, I have to be a professional, you know, and that's the thing about, in a way, you know, with Doctor Who, I had to sort of put the fanboy away and say that to do this job to the best of my ability, I had to apply all of my experience and instincts as an actor.
Oh, come on.
No, it's true. And then I ran around the top of some.
There you go. That's what I want.
Yeah.
Hi. Hi. Before I ask my question, I just wanted to let you know that you're my favorite doctor.
Thank you. That's great.
And my question is, was there a certain moment on set or filming a certain scene that you felt that you had finally arrived as your doctor?
Ooh, I don't think you ever feel that you know, to go back to talk to the professional actor, I don't feel as if you ever arrive. If you arrive, it's over. So you're always looking. But sometimes, so every time, when I work on the show, I'm always looking for who this doctor is. Sometimes it appears. Sometimes he just sort of is there because we keep pushing and keep working at it. But you know, from the moment you step out of the door, from the first moment you open the TARDIS door and pop your head out, you've got to be here. So really from the start, I felt as if I was playing him. But there were some special little moments where I felt he was there, which are my moments.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
Who is your favorite enemy?
Oh, yeah, well, I like the Daleks. I like the Mondasian Cybermen. Well, the original Cybermen. I like the Daemons, who are sort of strange kind of demon-like creatures. I like the Noctra, the Zabi, who are creatures from the Web Planet. I like I like so many of them. There are hundreds of them. I like Sontarans, you know. I like Weeping Angels, of course. Yes. And I like the strange veil that pursued me in Heaven Sent. I thought that was really sweet. I love the creature in Listen, which was never seen. We don't even know if it ever really existed, but it was such a kind of frightening presence. I love that. Who's your favorite?
The Daleks.
The Daleks. Glad to hear it. You're hardcore.
Thank you.
Yeah, the Weeping Angel just scared the crap out of me. But I love them. I love the Weeping Angels as well.
That's right. Hardcore. Hi.
Which is better, the sonic screwdriver or the sonic sunglasses?
Well, you know, in real life, if someone said to me, "You're going out to a club? Have you got your shades?" I'd say, "I've got my shades." But if they said to me, "Have you got your screwdriver?" I'd be like, "No." I think they're both fun. I think the screwdriver's great for blowing things up, and people like to play with it, and the toy manufacturers love it. But Ray-Bans love the shades.
Okay, this may be the last. We have to get him back down to the signing area, so this might be your magic ticket here.
Thanks for all that pressure. That was lovely. I am loud. Sorry. So I love your work. I've been following your body of work for a very long time, so I'm going to ask the slightly non-who but still who question about Torchwood.
Yeah.
About Frobisher, dear God, how did you feel when you read the script about that character, and what was, I guess, your impression of the friend reaction to his very reprehensible but sadly still kind of understandable choice at the end? Because I sobbed like a three-year-old for a good hour after that episode.
Well, I thought it was great. I mean, it was. I was surprised at how powerful it was, and I was surprised at the effect that it had on people and how popular it was. And they ran it in the UK. They ran it over 5 nights, so that was all a surprise to me that it was going to be taken so seriously, which was right that it was. And it's down to the talent of the team, of Russell T. Davis, and all those people that they could do a show like that with a character of such complexity. I thought it was really sad, but I thought, you know, this is, I love when sci-fi or fantasy shows are able to reflect some of the complexity of the real world, and in a way, this was a man who was locked into a position with no hope. He had no other choice than the choice he had to make to protect his family, which, you know, is awful, and sadly, in the world today, there are people who are faced with choices like that. So it was a privilege to do it, and I'm glad you liked it so much. Thank you.
Thank you. It was a privilege to watch you do that and what you continue to do, and Malcolm Tucker may be the best eloquent cursor I've ever met.
Thank you. And for forget a life.
I get to do this. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Dallas FanExpo, Dallas to be exact, is proud to present to you Mr. Peter